Good morning, guys, and welcome back to our macroeconomic session. Now, so far we have studied what is the balance of payment and what are the two major categories of balance of payment, that is our current account and our capital account. Now, there are also certain transactions which come after we have categorized all the transactions, or some transactions which we forgot to mention in the current account or the capital account, like you do while you're making your own balance sheet or that some traders balance sheet. It also happens with the government. The bad debts, the recovery of bad debts, these are also the transactions or also the events that happen with the government. So apart from current account and capital account, there is also one section of BOP which is called as the errors and omission. Errors and omissions are not such a category, major category, that we can determine which transactions come under this head. But I think from the name itself, you are well aware that if there are some adjustments to be made or there are some transactions which you forgot to record and then you have to record it at the last moment, all those transactions come here in the category of errors and omission. Okay. Now, coming back to the balance of your BOP. Now, when you talk about the current account, like I told you yesterday, it can either turn out to be a current account deficit or turn out to be a current account surplus, meaning that it can turn out to be a positive balance in current account or a negative balance in current account. Now, these things or these terms which are used interchangeably, these both the terms you have to know, because you don't know in exam what the paper setter will use, right? So when he says the debit balance, it means the debit side is more, means you know that the debit side results to deficit. If the debit side is more, it will result to deficit, and if the credit side is more, it means the incomes are greater, so it will turn to be a current account surplus. Similar thing goes to the capital account. As I told to you, when you talk about the borrowings, the inflow, you are talking about the credit side, and when you are talking about the repayments, you are talking about outflow, which you are talking about the debit side. So when I say the receipts are greater than the payments, I mean the entire capital account shows what? Your surplus. Now, when you take these things into account, both the current account and capital account, you will have three things. You will have a balance of payment surplus, you will have a balance of payment deficit, and then you will have a balance in your BOP. Balance of payment is balanced. So I think from the name itself, you will understand that when you talk about BOP surplus, you mean that the receipts are greater than the payments. When you talk about deficit, now receipts and payments are very general terms. We are talking about the foreign exchange. So what you have to understand is receipts means the capital inflow and payments means nothing but the outflow. These are the interchangeable words that you will have to use in the exams. So when I say there is a deficit in our balance of payment, when there is a deficit means you are paying more. The receipts that you are earning are less, and the outflow that is of the foreign exchange that is leaving your country to reach some other country or countries, then you can say that your BOP account shows deficit. And when it is a balance, it means receipts are equal to payments. Now, this is very general term, but like I said, BOP is nothing but the total calculation, total summation of your current account and capital account. So here, when I say the inflow is greater than the outflow, it means both the credit sides are greater than the debit side. When I say deficit, the debit side is greater than the credit side. But when I say balance, I mean to say one of the most important points that you will have to remember throughout is that your current account balance is equal to your capital account, is equal to zero. Means current plus capital should be equal to zero. And this is when you say that your balance of payments have achieved the balance. They have tallied. The most important thing that you have to, you know, you just want to get it done is that to tally your balance sheet. Similarly, when you talk about balance of payment, the name itself indicates that you have to balance the statement, means the current account plus your capital account should be equal to zero. Now, how is it possible that the current account and capital accounts will be zero? Because the major aim of any individual, firm, household, and accordingly the government will be to manage the outflows from the capital inflows or the current inflows that you are undertaking. Correct? So what if the invisible trades and the goods trades, both these things result in current account deficit? If they are in minus, if they are in negative, your capital account should have as much positive inflow to, you know, finance the current account deficit. That is why if current account has plus minus 5 deficit, then the capital account should have an inflow of at least 5 rupees so that your balance of payment is tallied, or you can say it has a balance or equilibrium in the economy. Okay, so this is the basic idea, but this is the ideal situation. Everybody wants this situation. But give and take, the economy never operates under equilibrium. You have to bring it into equilibrium. So what if we are facing surplus? Or what if we are facing deficit? Now, India, most of the time, we are under this category. Always, we are presenting what? A deficit budget. Correct? So when you say deficit, it does not mean that we are poor or we are lacking behind in development. Deficit sometimes means that you are giving out the foreign currency as an investment. You are making FDIs, you are making FIIs, correct? Offshore fundings for some other individual country, right? So, but then too, when we are in deficit, what is the resort that we should use? What is the final arrangement of funds that we need to do so that we come in the balance? Because ultimately, every economy, every country has to bring a current account plus capital account is equal to zero, means your balance of payment should be equal to zero. It should be financed equally. So what will happen when these either of these two things arise in the economy? This is your next part of the study, which is known as the official reserve transactions. What are the official reserve transactions? Official reserve transactions take place in the transactions which take place in the foreign exchange reserves of a country. Now, you are well aware what are the facilitating and the regulating functions of the RBI. One such function of the RBI is what? To hold the foreign exchange reserves on behalf of government. That is why RBI is called as the banker to government. Correct? So they hold the foreign exchange reserve on behalf of the government. So what happens in condition one? You have too much inflow. The foreign exchange is too much and the outflow is less than the inflow. What you can do is from that foreign exchange reserve, what you will do is purchase the security of other country, means you will have to deduct something from the foreign exchange because you are in the surplus. If you want, you are in the surplus and you have to have the balance, what you have to do is withdraw the foreign currency, correct? You will withdraw your foreign currency and then you will invest it somewhere else. So obviously, when you see this thing in the back of your mind as an individual, what you will think is if you have ample money, what you are going to do? If you have ample money, you are going to invest it somewhere. Similarly, when there is a balance of account, balance of payment surplus, the official reserve transactions, the money or the foreign exchange stock from the reserves is going to be withdrawn. Official reserve transaction. Official means it relates to the government and the RBI, and reserve are the stock of foreign exchange that you have. You always learn these things. Forex. What is Forex? Forex is foreign exchange. So these Forex reserves that a country has will be withdrawn in case of surplus, right? But what happens if we are in balance of payment deficit? If we are in deficit, means we want some more money. Right? So we are going to utilize the money. Correct? So in case of balance of payment deficit, if the outflow is more, the foreign exchange reserve transactions will help in bringing out the balance. Right? So learning this foreign exchange concept is not enough. What we are going to do is we are going to learn something forward, which is known as the accommodating transactions and the autonomous transactions. Now, I think from these two words, the word you are familiar with is the autonomous. Autonomous means having your own independence, having the ability or the capacity to take your own decisions. That is autonomous. So when you talk about official reserve transactions, these transactions are basically classified into these two categories, that is the accommodating transaction and the autonomous transaction. Now, as you know, autonomous transactions are the independent transactions, so they are more of a profit making transactions which are made with a view of only profit maximization. They are autonomous, they are not dependent on the country's state of BOP. They are undertaken by the RBI and by the government by seeing a profit making opportunity and acting upon it. But when you say accommodating, the word itself indicates that they are trying to accommodate something. Means, as a result of this autonomous transaction, there can be a fluctuation in the balance of POP. There can be a disequilibrium in the economy, and to adjust that disequilibrium and bring about a balance, the transactions that you undertake are called as the accommodating transactions. Means accommodating transactions do not have a profit maximization motive whatsoever for your economy. The only motive is to restore the balance of your BOP. We are going to see some points which will further, you know, clarify this theory. If I say autonomous, I am saying these transactions relate to the profit maximization view. Correct? If I say profit maximization view, I am saying that if a country finds some opportunity, they are going to use this opportunity, and as this is no profit maximization, these have no profit motive, but what motive it has is to restore the equilibrium. The equilibrium here is not the equilibrium of your demand and supply. We are in macroeconomics, so this equilibrium talks about the BOP balance. This talk about the BOP settlement. Okay, these are the settlement, official settlement transactions. And this autonomous, it causes the disequilibrium where it tries to restore the equilibrium, but due to certain transactions which you only undertake when you see a profit maximization or profit maximizing opportunity and you act upon it, that comprises of autonomous transaction and that ought to bring a disequilibrium. So it causes balance of payment disequilibrium. Correct? And that is why these transactions are called as below the line transaction. Below the line transactions, and these are above the line transactions. Right? Above the line and below the line, these are just the interchangeable terms that you can use for accommodating transactions and the autonomous transactions. Now, the only thing that I want to emphasize here is that when you talk about official reserve transactions, why are these transactions important for BOP? Is because logically you can say, okay, when there is a deficit, they will withdraw, they will use. If there is a surplus, they will invest somewhere. All this is okay, right? But what is the economic underlying condition for this? It is because it shows us or it portrays a scenario that the government and your central bank, these are the main, you can say, ultimate financier of a country. Because only the government, through the help of RBI or acting through RBI, can restore the balance of BOP. So this question of what are official reserve transactions and how are they important in the BOP balance or BOP equilibrium, this question has been asked every single time in your board exams. This is a 3 marks question. What are official reserve transactions and what importance do they have in BOP? So we know that official reserve transactions are nothing but the transactions which are undertaken by the government to finance the disequilibrium of your BOP are called as official reserve transactions. So you yourself have to find out how do you use these things in order to achieve the balance when there is a BOP surplus and when there is a BOP deficit. This is your assignment for today. It is just a 3 lines answer, I think. First, you have to define what is a official reserve transaction. Second point will be, in case of BOP deficit, what happens in the official reserve transaction? And third point will be, if there is a BOP surplus, what happens in the official reserve transaction? That's all. Try to be very precise, right? And then the another assignment is writing this distinguished, and you can add some examples also in case of autonomous transactions and your accommodating transactions, right? Now we have understood the entire working of BOP. When you come from trade account, then you enter the current account, and for current account you consider the trade balance, the invisible balance, the transfer payments. Then we move to capital account, which affects your assets and liabilities position. And then ultimately, when you add up the current account and capital account, the main aim as a government, as a country which you have, is to balance the BOP, means the current account plus capital account should be equal to zero, right? Now, this everything is what a calculation part. This is a part where you categorize everything that is happening in the country and you are trying to put out a statement which shows that either we are in balance or we are not in balance. If we were not in balance, how did we use our official reserve transactions, right? But this all is happening due to the foreign market, the international market. So now we are going to see what are the foreign exchange transactions. What is the foreign exchange rate? How are these rates determined in various types of markets, right? This is very important. Now, currently, if I ask you what is a foreign exchange rate, you will always say $1 is equal to this much rupee. You will never say 1 rupee is equal to this much dollars, because we know that the INR has very less value as compared to a US dollar. So it comes from the time of Bretton Woods. Bretton Woods was a person who introduced this system, Bretton Woods system, in which earlier there were gold exchange, gold reserves, and in terms of gold, the country which had maximum gold reserve will be considered the dominating country, and all the currencies will be internationally expressed in terms of the country's currency with maximum gold reserves. But this is not the case today. Then the gold started becoming what? A dead investment, correct? The bullion market today is on the high rise, but we cannot invest in gold because it is a dead investment. Today we are more keen in investing our funds in the shares and securities, like we studied the FIIs, the FGIs, all these things, correct? The share market. So what I mean to say is, today we have to learn why is this happening. It is easier said that, okay, the US is a superpower, that is why maybe our currency is expressed in terms of US dollars. No, I'll tell you, the currency in Kuwait is maximum, has the maximum exchange rate, right? More than the US dollar. It is like 240 rupees INR. But a US dollar is something like 70 to 75 currently. So this is very starting point of our foreign or international market understanding, that why do we express our INR in terms of US dollars is because US dollars is the standard thing. US is a country which deals with almost every country in the world. So the exchange becomes very convenient. Every country's central bank, all the banks are conveniently able to exchange the US dollars into some other local currency. That is why we are always expressing the exchange rate as USD to INR, right? So let's understand how is this exchange rate formed, or what actually is the exchange rate. Now for understanding what is a foreign exchange rate, or what are the rates in international market, you need to first understand that these are determined by certain calculations. These are determined by the operations of the economy. First one is the flexible exchange rate. Second is the fixed exchange rate. And we also have one combination of these two things, which is called as the managed or floating or dirty exchange rate, it is called. Okay, so let's talk about flexible exchange rate. Now, when you talk about flexible exchange rate, the name itself indicates that the exchange rate will keep on changing, which is the current scenario that we see. Daily you go and you check, every day the exchange rate will be different depending on how the international markets operate. When you say flexible exchange rate, it is very, very obvious that you are talking about the trade of international countries, right? The international money market, what happens in the money market affects your flexible exchange rate. Now, as the word flexible indicates, in short, flexible exchange rate is determined by the market forces of demand and supply. Now, this demand and supply is not the goods and services demand and supply. This demand and supply is the demand and supply of foreign currency. So, how can we say the demand of foreign currency? If I say I am demanding more US dollars, it means I am trying to sell more and more goods so that my goods and services cross the boundaries of US and I get the foreign exchange reserves in terms of US dollars. Correct? That is the demand for foreign currency, and the supply for foreign currency is when you supply the foreign currency to other country. Your home currency will be a foreign currency to some other country. So when the demand and supply for foreign exchange intersect, that equilibrium price, as you may have seen a couple of times, this X diagram and this equilibrium price, this is your foreign exchange rate, Forex. This is your equilibrium right over here. But when you say fixed exchange rate, the word fixed means there is some fixed rate which is considered by each and every country involved who uses this fixed exchange rate. There is also another word used for fixed. It is pegged. When you say fixed, you think somebody else comes into picture and then they fix the exchange rate and we all are the price takers and we say, okay, we will follow this. But when you hear this word pegged, you understand that in here there are some mechanisms due to which a foreign exchange rate is fixed. So in foreign exchange fixed rate or fixed method, what is done is government pegs a highest foreign exchange rate and it does not change it for a considerable period of time, and later then it changes and that becomes fixed for a considerable period of time, so on and so forth. Now this pegging means fixing a price by somebody, by an authority. The authority in that case is the government. In further lectures we will see how government and which government is authorized to set these prices, right? But when we combine these two things, we come to our managed or floating system of exchange rate. Now simple thing, that if you leave this foreign exchange determination to the market forces of demand and supply, what will happen is the market is fluctuating so much that your economy will never be stabilized in terms of international transactions. Or if you say we are keeping a fixed exchange rate, what will happen is it will become very rigid. And in today's terms, you know, everything is so dynamic. We are working in a dynamic economy. Every day something changes. Now, current scenario, you see, in 2020, we have seen so much of things happening all at once. Like life is coming right at you with so much speed that you don't have a time to even stabilize yourself. Do you imagine what is happening to the economy at current times? We are only worried that we are out of jobs, we don't have to do anything, we are locked down in house. But you think about the economy as a whole, even though existing scenario is that we are a developing country, and being that now we are facing such a crisis as all over the world, but then what is going to happen when all of this subsides? Hopefully eventually it's going to subside. And what is going to happen? The only thing that every country is worried about now, whether to survive or to not. Because if people in the country do not survive, if the opportunities are getting wiped out by every hour, if not a day, right? If they are getting wiped out so fast, what is going to happen? In this scenario, if you want to, you know, keep a fixed exchange rate, what is going to happen? It's going to become very rigid. You are not, you know, in terms of British rule also, we saw that the things that they imposed on us were very rigid, and that is why we could not work with them. Similarly, here also, when we are independent country and through the reforms that we have studied, the globalization has brought in so many opportunities. In these times, if you stick to this fixed exchange system, nobody is going to operate freely in this market. There will be no license for economy. But then, if we keep these two extremes, what is going to happen? Something or someone is going to suffer. So we combine the best part of these two things and we come up with the managed floating. Managed floating means the government and the market forces work together. For example, if the market sources are fluctuating too much, there is an excess supply, the government will do something to bring it down and achieve the equilibrium. Means it will do some autonomous, some accommodating transactions in order to bring the equilibrium. That is the managed floating system. This is a brief overview of what the flexible, fixed and the managed floating rates are. And in the next session, we will see the entire balance of payment table. How does the balance of payment of a country look like? And then we are going to study the various foreign exchange systems. I'll leave you there. Thank you.